Today I want to look at establishing structure in the landscape, and we do this mainly through the use of trees and shrubs. Trees and shrubs are the backbone of a garden. I'm going to focus here on trees, and I like to think of trees as two layers, producing two different layers in the landscape. The upper canopy and then an understory layer. So we can think of the canopy layer as the large shade trees, and then the understory layer are the lower growing trees that might grow in the shade of the larger ones or along the edge of the tree line where they get more light. Now when it comes to working in an edible landscape, you might have established trees that you need to work around. Here we have an oak tree that's already there, and we're building our edible landscape around it. But if you're starting fresh, you might select a canopy tree that produces edible nuts, such as our pecan. And here we have a native pecan. You can also plant paper shell pecans and other improved cultivars. All of them are very well adapted to the landscape. One thing we want to consider is giving them plenty of room. Eventually they'll grow and shade out the plants below it. So you want to remember to place them in a location where they won't shade the entire edible garden. Most of our fruit trees fall into the category of the understory tree. They're lower growing in size. Many of them will reach only 15 to 20 feet once they mature. Now, I use the word understory more to describe their size because many of them actually want to be in a very sunny location, but you can find a few that will tolerate shade. Now the understory or lower canopy trees provide a good amount of structure in the garden, and one good use that I have in here is I'm putting them sort of in the back of our edible landscape to provide a bit of a backdrop. Now that in addition to providing structure, here I have an Asian persimmon, and it also has some beautiful ornamental traits. It has these very deep green glossy leaves, which are quite striking. And in the fall, they'll take on a beautiful fall color. The fruits, once it starts to produce fruits, are going to hang on long after the leaves fall and be very ornamental, kind of like little Christmas decorations. So it's also a very beautiful plant to use. Now this is an Asian persimmon, and it's marginally hardy here in Stillwater, so we're taking a little bit of a risk with it. In the southern part of the state, it will certainly do much better. At the far end of our garden, we have a fig tree, and this is brown turkey. This is one that's selected for its cold tolerance. And again, depending on the specific conditions of the planting location, if it's exposed to really cold temperatures, it could die back over the winter. But if it's given some protection, it can actually develop into a large shrub or small tree around 12 to 15 feet in size. When selecting fruit trees for the edible landscape, you want to consider mature size, adaptability to our climate, and ease of maintenance. Many fruit trees are prone to insect and disease problems. A great example is fire blight in our apples and pears. Fire blight produces these very characteristic shepherd crook looking patterns of dieback. Now we can avoid this by selecting a disease-resistant cultivar, and that'll make our maintenance a little bit easier. Another thing we want to consider is the mature size. Now fortunately, many of our fruit trees are available on dwarfing rootstocks that limit the mature size. And by selecting these dwarfing rootstocks and also through some pruning, we could keep the plants at a much more manageable size. This is an example of a peach tree, Carolina Bell, that's grown on a dwarfing rootstock. And by combining this with a bit of pruning, we could keep it at about 8 feet in canopy size. Another type of dwarfing is the columnar varieties of apples. We have a golden sentinel, and right now it's fairly young, just getting started, but it'll mature to a width of only 2 feet. It'll grow fairly tall, so it takes up vertical space, but it doesn't take a lot of lateral space on the ground. Now when you're selecting fruits, don't limit yourself to just those that are very common. There's a lot of underutilized and even some native fruits that make wonderful edible additions to the landscape. A great example is this jujube tree. This is a native from China, and it produces small fruits that have sort of a caramel apple flavor, and they can be eaten right off the tree. They're just a wonderful treat. Now, we don't readily find these in the market, so the best way to enjoy them is to produce your own. A wonderful native tree for the landscape is the pawpaw. And pawpaws have a magnificent form. They produce this rather pyramidal shaped canopy that will mature at about 20 feet tall. It also has very large leaves and it gives it almost a tropical appearance, certainly very striking. The fruits, here's some immature fruits. They'll mature to about three times this size, and they have almost a banana custard flavor. They're just delicious. Pawpaws are often found in the understory of large trees in nature, and so you can use these in some of those shadier spots in the landscape. Another thing we want to consider with fruit trees is pollination. That's the transfer of pollen from the male flowers or male parts of the flower to the female parts of the flower. Now, in some fruit trees, they're what we call self-pollinating, and that means that the male flowers on a single tree can pollinate the female flowers on that tree or the female portion. And the reason I say flowers or portion of the flower is some trees actually produce separate male and female flowers. Other types of trees are cross-pollinated, and with these, it's very important to pay attention to that because you require two individual specimens, typically of a different variety, in order to get good pollination. And the male flowers on one of those will pollinate the females on the other plant. So we need two separate plants, and in a limited landscape, that could be an issue. One thing that we've done to get around that is we're experimenting with a method called high density planting. And here you can see there's three trunks. So we're placing three, you could do two to four really different varieties in the same planting space. They have to be dwarf and you have to prune them so that they can compete well. Now, when we're considering pollination, fruits that are self-pollinating include apricots, European plums, tart cherries, figs, peaches, and nectarines. Fruits requiring cross-pollination include apples, pears, sweet cherries, Japanese plums, pawpaws, and jujubes. Pecan trees are also cross-pollinated, but there tend to be plenty around to provide the pollen needed. Now, it's important to remember that bees are the primary source of pollination, so we need to protect them and tolerate them in our edible landscape. One final consideration in locating your fruit trees is that they can drop fruit, which might be a mess. So we want to avoid putting them in places where they might be a nuisance, such as along driveways or patios. We'll return to our edible landscape to look at ways of incorporating shrubs, flowers, and herbs.